I'm Gary, and this is Coasting with Culture. I like to combine theme park visits and riding roller coasters with various cultural experiences around the world. Previously, I crossed the British Columbia and Alberta provincial line, enjoying the sights of the gorgeous Glacier, Yoho, and Banff National Parks, and made a stop at Callaway Park for a return visit from my last visit in Alberta. Next, it's time for the reason for this road trip, the Calgary Stampede. While attending, there will be shows to watch, food to try, and of course, coasters to ride. The night will cap off with one of the biggest events and shows of the Stampede, the Chuck Wagon Races and Nighttime Show.
About to hop aboard the train from Crowfoot here, just on the outskirts of Calgary, to go into the city center. The suggestion was made by my host last night to take advantage of the train instead of paying the higher parking price, because I'm heading into Calgary for the Stampede.
Taking advantage of the C train to get into Calgary was great, as it was affordable, being under $4 Canadian, and it has two stops for Stampede Park. So I wouldn't have to go far to get in or to take the train back at the end of the night. The ride itself was pretty fun, as you get to see the suburban outskirts of Calgary before getting to downtown. Before long, the train arrived to the Victoria Park stop, which is the first stop for the Stampede. The train just about drops you off right at the front gate, making it a great convenient way to come rather than to fight traffic or pay for higher parking costs. The grounds of the Stampede are rather large, with a lot to see and do, so I started with the BMO Center, located right next to the main entrance. This is the Stampede's commercial space, where they have a large number of vendors that give demonstrations with items for sale, ranging from appliances and tools to furniture and clothing. This is pretty common for many fairs and expos like this, but this particular building had an added touch. It has this entertainment area for kids to play in the daytime, and it becomes a lounge space at night for adults.
One of the cool things I'm seeing above this play area are these floating orbs that change color. It reminds me a lot of that orb show that was back in the Gentian Highlands during my trip to Asia earlier this year. So it's kind of cool to see this here. Definitely not as detailed, but still really neat to see.
So the Stampede has a ton of food options. We're gonna try to find some here in a minute, but if you find yourself trying to figure out what you should get, you could always join a Stampede food tour.
Of course, you've gotta try out the food, but there are a few items I don't think I'd be a fan of.
No, absolutely not. This is a crime against humanity.
They're advertising Butterbeer Soft Serve. Might have to give this a try and see if it's any good, see if it's anything like the Butterbeer Soft Serve at Universal.
I can't say that it was exactly the same, but it was really good. One thing I really appreciate about the Stampede grounds are the artistic tributes to the heritage of the Stampede and to the nation of Canada.
On the grounds of the Stampede, there's this really neat set of statues that are set up that symbolize horses crossing over the Bow River. The ones that are in the middle are supposed to be the ones that are inside the river itself, and then the ones on the sides are heading toward the river, going across, and a couple of them have the cowboys riding on top of them. Now, today it's kids riding on top of the horses.
One of the coolest things that I've noticed is that all the guest services desks that are inside of the fairgrounds here have the cowboy hat that has a question mark in front. Love the theming of this place.
Another building to explore is the agriculture zone, where a variety of animals are on display for visitors to see, especially the horses.
This quarter horse has a little baby with her.
While the horses are more prominent, you can find several other animals as well.
In case anybody's wondering, this llama has Instagram. Manny the Llama. Manny, how many Instagram followers do you have? I guess he's just trying to be humble, or he knows he has more Instagram followers than I have subscribers right now. Fair enough, Manny. Fair enough.
After seeing the animals, there's even more to explore.
The Scotiabank Saddle Dome, which is home to the Calgary Flames and the Calgary Hitmen, is part of the same grounds as the Calgary Stampede. Looks like the building's open, so I'm kind of curious to see what might be going on inside.
Along with having souvenirs for the Saddle Dome's two hockey teams, the doors into the main concourse are also open for visitors to take a look inside. While the arena was being set up for Stampede concerts, ushers were on hand to tell people about the arena and point out its features, like a mini tour.
So we had a chance to see the market area, had a chance to see some animals, but I'm thinking that it might be time to go ahead and start doing some rides. And the rides are kind of scattered all over the place. Looks like a lot of the smaller rides might be over toward this direction. And then looking back over toward this side would be the area where the bigger rides are located.
The carnival for this year's Stampede was presented by North American Midway Entertainment and offered a variety of rides that are common at carnivals, but there were a couple I hadn't seen before.
Oh man, if they had this when I was a kid, I would have lost my mind. Getting to ride a monster truck as it goes over cars, holy smokes, I would have lost it.
Of course, I always keep a lookout for coasters. And since I had never been to an event with this company before, all of them would be new credits, starting with their Wacky Worm. Yep, another shameless credit.
This sign shows that these guys get me.
The second coaster I rode in the smaller rides area was called the Dragon. This was pretty unique as it wasn't like any other shameless credit I've been on.
Hear me out, because Dragon here right behind me has a little bit of a special feature to it. You see, if you look at the way that it starts, it backs up, it goes forward through the tires, and it goes around that first hill and then down and around. But the catch though is that you'll notice that first hill lacks any tires. So it essentially launches from the station after it backs up and gets momentum going. So I'm pretty sure that this counts as a traveling launch roller coaster.
Near this area were some special guests of the Stampede, the Budweiser Clydesdales. They also brought the Dalmatian to say hello as well. Just over the other side of the Bow River was NMAX Park, a special heritage park dedicated to the native tribes of Alberta.
So if it wasn't on my bucket list before, it is now, and it's been checked off. I got a picture with an actual Mountie. Two of them to be exact.
Back outside of the Saddle Dome, you can watch the performances of the Calgary Stampede Show Band, a tradition of the event since 1971 that features musicians and performers between 16 and 21 years old. They were fun to watch and listen to.
Thank you.
After that, I wanted to try more food.
This food truck here is specializing in cookie dough, and they have cookie dough burritos. Apparently it's cookie dough that's wrapped up in candy and cotton candy, so it's just a big diabetic mess waiting to happen. Not sure if I'm ready for that much sugar today, but I do see the deep fried cookie dough, so I might have to give that a try.
It was a bit soon after ice cream, so I'd save it for later. I was actually ready for lunch.
So there's all these food choices here at the Stampede, but I feel like if I'm going to choose one place, because I'm in Canada, I'm going straight to the Poutine King. So I got the Philly Steak Poutine. It's got the gravy, the cheese curds, the fries, and then they've also got the steak, along with some cheddar cheese in there. This does normally come with onions and mushrooms as well. Personally, I'm not a big fan of those, but this looks absolutely fantastic.
Having eaten, I was ready for more rides. So I walked over to the area with the bigger rides. If you're more of a thrill seeker, this is definitely the section of the Stampede to come to. There was one in particular that I knew I'd be getting on today, and that was the Crazy Mouse. Of course. I'm usually a fan of these spinning mouse coasters, but this one gave a rather odd ride.
So I've been riding roller coasters for over 20 years now, and I have to say I've never been on a spinning wild mouse that didn't spin. You know, that one just passed and that one spins, but there's one car, and I saw it going a few minutes ago, it literally doesn't spin. Like, it doesn't disconnect from whatever keeps it locked in place during the first part of the ride, and then the second half of the ride it starts to spin around, so it's really bizarre. Never had that happen before.
And so watching this green car as it comes through, right there is where it disengages, and then it starts spinning right there. But the one that I was on did not. I don't know if it was just a balancing thing, because I did have two kids that were riding with me, a little bit smaller than I am, but yeah, never had that happen before where it did not spin at all.
The last coaster of the day would be in the form of this galaxy-style coaster known as Outlaw. If there is one thing I'll give the ride operators a ton of credit for, they knew how to keep the ride going at a higher capacity, running as many cars at a time as they could, helping to minimize the weight. If you're wanting a memento for your day at the Stampede, they have a number of souvenir stands throughout the grounds offering various t-shirts. And if you don't have your own cowboy hat, they have those as well. One other ride I really wanted to check out was the WestJet Skyride. This offers you the opportunity for a gentle ride above the midways of the Stampede to see the grounds from a different perspective. The Skyride was a great way to see the Stampede from above, and it turns out its sponsor had a special activity. WestJet, the Canadian airline, had a special carnival game set up to promote their brand. This is one of those rollerball games where your plane moves based on which of the holes your ball falls into.
So I didn't do very well, but I did get a WestJet sticker.
I felt like I was ready for another treat, but the failure would continue after the game.
So all the chocolate chip cookie dough at the truck was gone. No deep fried cookie dough to try today. But I saw something else that caught my eye, and I think I might go ahead and give that a try instead. So apparently it's a tradition in the Calgary Stampede to get mini donuts, and these red velvet ones were pretty good, as you can see based on my stick here. They were delicious.
I wanted to scope out some of the more adult options of the Stampede, so I went into the Big Four Roadhouse. This is a combination music hall and lounge space for those old enough to enjoy adult beverages, where they can come and enjoy the music with a beverage or two, or participate in recreational games while hanging out with friends. So I had myself a beer and listened to the music for a bit. Back outside, I became rather intrigued by one of the big differences between this midway and midways in the United States.
So, you know, carnival games are a staple of any carnival that you go to, and it seems to be the case here at the Calgary Stampede as well. What I found really fascinating, though, is that there are carnival games that involve gambling. You can actually put money on the line and win money in return. Some versions it's based on picking the winning color, other versions based on if it's going to be over or under a certain total, in most cases the number 7. There's another variation that involves choosing the right symbol and get paid out based on how many times that symbol comes up, if it does. And then there's one that's based off of choosing a spot with multiple spinners, and the number of spinners that land on there also will pay you that number of times, but because there's so many more options and so many arms, not very likely you're going to get that many times in the same spot. But really fascinating to see that they have gambling at carnivals here in Canada. You would never see that in the States.
For the life of me, I can't remember what grade I was in, but I saw a picture from one of the chuck wagon races in a math textbook, and I remember thinking it was neat that they had races with wagons like this. Fast forward to my last visit in Alberta, and seeing the grounds of the Stampede made me even more interested in coming to the event. This evening was going to give me the chance to see something I had been curious about since at least middle school. On top of that, it would also include an evening show, which this year's version of the show is called Trailblazer. The main grandstands are where people come to watch the races along with the afternoon rodeos, both of which happen every single day of the Stampede. The track is very similar to that of a traditional horse racing track. Before the race begins, the Calgary Stampede show band and several honorees come to the stage for the presentation of the Canadian National Anthem. Once the ceremonies are done, it's time to go racing. This is a huge event, and it's treated as such when the drivers are introduced and shown on the screen for each heat. As they approach the start, each team takes a quick warm-up lap involving a figure-eight pattern before going down the track. When they come back to the starting line, they await the horn to signal the start of the race. Between heats, they would occasionally bring out special guests, like the Budweiser Clydesdales, to have a parade lap. This was a good time to sneak down to the railing for a heat to see what it's like up close. One thing you'll notice about the wagons is that many of them have sponsors, so it's almost like NASCAR with horses. After the quick practice ride, it's showtime. There are 8 heats in all each day, and some of them were really close. But when the racing ends, the party's not done yet. They bring out a massive staging and video rig for the nighttime show, which includes music, dance, fireworks, and more. The main dance ensemble is known as the Young Canadians, and they complement many of the main acts of this awesome musical variety show.
So it's already the next morning, as you can tell, based on the daylight. Unfortunately, my phone died last night while at the Stampede, and I didn't get a chance to plug it in until I got back to my car. Really did enjoy the Stampede. It was a great time. Definitely fulfilling to get a chance to take that off of my list of things to experience. And now begins the long trek home.
The drive home was a bit more direct in the sense that I didn't stop as much either day of the return as I did coming up. But the first part of the drive was a nice reminder of just how incredible the difference is between the Alberta Prairie and the Canadian Rockies. I went past Revelstoke and continued until I got to the city of Kamloops, where I stopped for the night. Then the next day, I went the rest of the way back home to the Seattle area. And that was my short but sweet Western Canada road trip. It was great to enjoy the Canadian mountains along the way, and to find several coasters to ride, some of which were new credits. I'd like to thank you all for checking out my Western Canada adventure, and I hope that you'll come back for more Coasting with Culture. Thank you for watching this Coasting with Culture video. If you'd like to see future videos about combining theme park visits and cultural experiences, please consider clicking that subscribe button down below. You'll also find Coasting with Culture on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, plus more content at coastingwithculture.com. Until next time, take care and safe travels.